To let you know before we get started that we are going to record this session so that we can send everyone a link to the video so that, you know, anyone who wasn't able to join us or anyone who needs to leave early for whatever reason can have access to the full video. My name is Rosie Warburg. I'm the Project Ready project manager. So I am kind of knee deep in the project every day going into classrooms. And really, it's kind of my primary focus right now is Project Ready and getting it out into classrooms. So we have two other panelists with us today. If you would like to introduce yourselves, is that okay? All right.
I'm Dr. Amy Murdoch and part of the Project Ready team.
Great.
And I'm Maria Aielli, also a member of the team.
And Dr. Murdoch is being very humble here. She is the creator of Project Ready. So she is kind of the big boss in charge who oversees everything. And we're so glad to have her working with us. And Maria as well does a lot of coaching and going into classrooms. So today we are going to talk about setting up your physical space in the classroom and then get into some of the Project Ready specific dramatic play centers. So I am going to share my screen here. And ladies, jump in. Let me know if you can't see this here.
Looks good, Rosie.
Looks good. Okay.
I should say, while Rosie's setting up, Maria and I will be monitoring the Q&A. So if you have questions, you can put them in along the way, and we will monitor that and help Rosie know when there's a good question to talk about with the whole group.
Great. And just jump in at any point, ladies. Let me know when you see something. Okay. All right. So this morning, I'm kind of channeling our Cincinnati weather here. It is a freezing, icy morning here on the Saturday morning. So I decided to kind of channel that with my blue theme for my PowerPoint here. So here's our agenda for today. First, we're going to talk about, you know, why we are talking about setting up centers in our classrooms. And we're going to cover some of the how, looking at the physical environment and some tips and tricks that we have learned from being in so many classrooms. And then we're going to really delve into each of the Project Ready Dramatic Play Centers that go along with our specific unit themes. So first of all, you know, I want to talk about why. Why are we talking about setting up our classrooms here? Isn't Project Ready a curriculum? So why does it matter that we're setting up or talking about setting up our classrooms? And the answer is yes, it is a curriculum. But a key component of our curriculum is small group instruction. So in the preschool classroom, small group instruction really means that many of your children need to be able to successfully engage in center activities independently so that you are freed up to do your small group instruction. So that's why we're talking about centers and setting up your classroom for success there. So we will dive into this more deeply in 2 weeks when we really cover each of the routines. But center time generally is done right after the 1-2-3 storybook routine and the whole group circle time. So after the book is read and we do our dialogic reading together, teachers generally dismiss students off to classroom centers to engage in those centers independently. And then during that time, it's typically about 60 minutes. So an hour of time for small groups and center time. During that time, teachers are going to pull their small groups together for alphabetics and oral language routines. Some of those groups, like alphabetics and math, should be carefully planned so that students are together with similar skill levels so they can really have their skills targeted there. And then other groups are oral language small groups, so telling terrific tales, Sammy, and the 1-2-3 reread. Those can be more flexible, heterogeneous groups where kids are kind of invited as they transition from one center activity to another. So we will dive into those routines more deeply so you can understand them a little bit more. But what you need to know right now is that really thinking about the curriculum needs as you set up your classroom can really allow for successful implementation. So there is a reciprocal relationship between implementation and setting up your center time in a way that can help it run smoothly. So the better your students are able to engage in that center time independently, the more implementation of the small groups you can do, and the more implementation of the small groups you can do, the more smoothly your center time works. So there's kind of a reciprocal relationship there between the two. So let's talk briefly here about kind of some things to think about with your physical environment. So really being proactive, looking at your physical environment of your classroom and thinking about how it's set up to help your center time move smoothly or to run smoothly. So we have been in many, many classrooms. We've been consulting and coaching in preschool classrooms for years now. So we understand, you know, every classroom has its own unique needs. Every teacher and all students have their own unique needs. But these are some things that we've really kind of come across that can help center time to move really smoothly. And these are some proactive things that you can do to encourage that in your classroom. So first of all, think about rotating your material. So I know we each have our own different needs and our own storage needs that are available to us. But thinking about rotating your material. So having 2 to 3 sets of materials for each of your centers, watching your students carefully for signs of disengagement, because we know as students kind of master the materials, that can lead to some boredom. And when you notice that, you notice students not engaging quite as deeply as they were before, think about rotating those materials out and adding in some new. So along the same lines, as you're setting up your shelves, keep in mind that in the preschool classroom, oftentimes less is more. So displaying your materials in an inviting way on shelves, making sure students can really see everything that's available and making sure they can remove it easily from the shelf. So making sure things aren't really stacked or kind of hidden behind other things so that they're visible and easy for little hands to move and manipulate. And then keeping in mind that having fewer items available really helps students to make their choices quickly and allows for frequent rotation of material. So a higher level of engagement there. So just keeping that in mind as you're setting up your shelves. Another thing to consider is thinking about the furniture that you have available to you and making sure you're placing it kind of carefully in your classroom in a way that each center almost has physical boundaries with the shelves and the tables that you have set up. So it's very clear when someone walks into a classroom, they can see, you know, oh, this is a center for this, and this is a center for science, and children are engaging with this over here. So really making it clear to students, this area is for this purpose, and using the furniture carefully to do that can be really beneficial. Another way to think about the placement of furniture is kind of watching closely if there's a space where children are moving too quickly. We know that some spaces in classrooms kind of encourage that, almost like a running around the classroom. So thinking about setting up your furniture in a way to discourage that and to encourage really careful, slow movement around the classroom. As much as possible, the furniture that is at child height should contain material that's available for student use. If there is anything that really is only for teachers, it should be pretty clearly marked so that students know, you know, this is not something that is open for me. And that really just kind of allows students to engage freely with the materials that are in their classroom. They know that everything that is there is for them and they have access to it. And if it is not for them, it's very clearly marked, if that makes sense. Okay. And we kind of touched on this already, but making sure you have clearly defined spaces for play. So in each center, there should be an area where children can take the materials and play with them. So things in the block center, stay in the block center. Things in the math center, stay here in the math center, and they are used at this table or on this rug, if that makes sense. So we really want children to be developing kind of their schema around the academic classroom environment. So these are math materials. Math has numbers and colors and counting, and they're really, as they're engaging with those different materials, they're building their schema around the concept of math and what math is. So we really do want children to kind of keep materials in each center. So they're not kind of moving things from one space in the classroom to another and really kind of engaging with things in more of a kind of a creative free way that would kind of confuse those ideas of, you know, this is math and this is a letter work. Okay. I know that's kind of a big, broad idea. So if you have any questions about that, feel free to put them in the chat and we can answer those. So another thing to consider when you're setting up your shelves in your classroom environment is really choosing highly impactful materials. So materials that are beautiful, they're appealing, they're inviting, and whenever possible, materials that allow students to practice multiple skills at once. Is really important there. And then of course, as you're setting up your room, you should always leave a space for the theme-based dramatic play center that is introduced in each of our units. Sometimes it happens kind of early in the unit. Sometimes the theme-based center is introduced later in the unit. So think intentionally about where you want to include that center in your classroom. Keep those things in mind, that it's not always at the opening at the beginning of a center. And then the details for each of the dramatic play centers are outlined in the units. You can find our units on our website, and we're going to take a closer look at each of those units here soon. So as we've spent time in classrooms here, we've kind of come up with some tips and tricks that really we find work well in pretty much all classrooms. So thinking about some of the challenges that we frequently see in preschool classrooms, these are some things that we can do to be really proactive in helping the center and small group time to go smoothly. So one thing that we really want to make sure we're doing is teaching students how to use each of the materials that are available during center time from beginning to end. So this is how we make a choice from the shelf. This is where we take this work when we're in this center. This is how we work with this from the very beginning to the very end of, you know, whatever the material is. And then when we're done, we're going to put it back together and we're going to put it on the same spot in the shelf. So really, as you're introducing new works and very much kind of at the beginning of the year, or as you've rotated things out, we should be making sure that there are teachers who are available, or one teacher who's available, really to monitor the use of those new materials, to really teach students how to use them kind of from beginning to end there, and how to be successful with interacting with them. And sometimes that means that for a period of time in your classroom, you're going to get fewer small groups in, because you're really focused on helping students to engage appropriately with those new materials. And that is okay, because again, there's that reciprocal relationship. As students are able to engage in center time appropriately, then we're able to do more with implementation. And as we can implement more, then our students become more successful in center time as well. One thing that we see pretty often with little preschoolers is not wanting to leave a material that they're really engaged in for a small group. That happens all the time. So one thing I think that can really be helpful there is having a system in place where students can kind of show their classmates, I'm not done using this material, but I'm going to go do a quick alphabetics lesson and I'm going to be back in 10 minutes. And when I come back, I'd really like to have this material still available for me. So sometimes teachers will take name cards for each student in the classroom and have those available, so that when students are invited to join a small group and they don't want to put away the work that they're doing, they can leave their name tag on that work to show their classmates, you know, hey, someone's still using this. It's not available to others right now. So then when students are done with their small group, they know they can go back and what they were doing is still available to them. Okay. Another thing to keep in mind is that as you're doing your small groups, you are kind of less available to the students in the center time. So sometimes teachers will use like a kind of a written sign that says, oh, I'm not available right now, or like a hand signal that can tell friends, you know, hey, I'm doing this small group. I'm not quite available right now. Of course, when you're using that kind of system, you really do have to teach children ahead of time what that sign or that hand signal means. And you really do have to take some time to help students kind of problem solve through some basic things that can happen during center time. So thinking about how to handle some things on their own that could come up during center time. So being really proactive and teaching those skills ahead of time can be really helpful with getting through your small groups there. And then, of course, we always want to make sure as teachers that we are modeling the behavior that we want to see from our students. So during center time, we want students to be talking in a low voice. So as we're doing our small groups, we want to make sure that we are modeling that low voice and using that appropriate voice level so that everything is kind of peaceful and quiet. Amy, did you need something?
I just wanted to let you know, we do have a good question.
Absolutely.
And I thought it might be good to talk about here.
Perfect.
So if you present a new material to the whole group, a small group, or individual children?
Oh, that's a great question. So I do think it probably depends on the material and the work. I think if it's something that is bigger and you can kind of model with the whole group, how to use it and how to choose it from the shelf and interact with it appropriately, I think you can do it in the whole group setting. If it's something where you really want to model and have children putting their hands on the material as you are with them and kind of talking through how to use it appropriately, then a smaller group setting, I think, is probably appropriate. Does that make sense? So I think it depends on, you know, your classroom needs. And then I think it also depends on the individual work. But I do think we get a lot of success when we can do it in smaller groups, introduce materials in kind of smaller groups. So organically during center time. Did we answer that question?
I think so. Thank you.
Okay. All right. If you have any follow-up questions, just let us know. Okay. Another thing kind of to keep in mind is just thinking about how you want students to be moving during small group center time, moving slowly and with purpose on your own, making sure that if you are trying to call students to your groups, you're going to model an appropriate voice, you're going to move towards students to get their attention as opposed to kind of like calling across the classroom to get students' attention. Okay, so really thinking about yourself and what you're modeling there and making sure that you are doing what you expect your little ones to do, because they will watch and they are little sponges. We know that. So I just hinted on this, but when you need to make an announcement during center time or you need to invite students to a new group, one thing that can be really helpful is using a tool to kind of get student attention. So a chime or a little bell or something like that, where you can kind of teach children from the beginning of the year, hey, this sound means everyone pause. Now, remember, you know, we're talking about preschool, so everybody pause can mean a little bit, you know, it can look a little bit different in a preschool classroom than with older children. But when you hear the sound, it means something important is an important announcement is about to be made. So really stop and pay attention here. That can help get students' attention and can kind of keep this peaceful environment going. Keeping in mind, of course, if you need to invite students to a group, we want to be modeling using that appropriate voice level. So moving towards students and talking with them in kind of a quieter voice. Hey, do you want to come join me for this group? Or, oh, it's your turn for alphabetics. Come on, we're going to do this today. Come join me. It's your turn. As opposed to kind of staying in your small group space and kind of calling across the classroom. We really want to make sure we're modeling that kind of quiet voice and the behavior that we want to see from kids. So keeping the peace there, keeping this kind of a quiet, peaceful time can be really helpful. Okay, so some possible centers. Every classroom is different. You have different materials available to you, but keeping all of those tips and tricks in mind, here are some centers that we have seen used really well in the classrooms that we're in. So a math center, letter exploration can be really fun, science centers with some more open-ended things, blocks, writing, both pre-writing and actual letter formation. And then these two here at the bottom, the self-care and classroom care can be really beneficial in keeping center time moving smoothly. So giving students some independence there. So in general, as you're setting up each of your centers, you want to consider your state standards and the skill needs of your students. ideal choices to set out for your students are kind of self-correcting, highly powerful manipulatives that encourage students to independently practice many skills at once. Your material should be inviting and stored beautifully with all of the necessary pieces and tools in place. It's important to check over your materials periodically to make sure nothing's broken or missing so that students can really be successful with the materials independently. And then, of course, as you're introducing new materials, you should do it carefully and model appropriate use of each of those materials. And then for students to be extra successful or their most successful, we should keep in mind that we really want to target their skills that have already been taught or skills that are already known by our students. So some ideas for highly engaging math materials here. We've got some more open-ended things like the wooden shapes, the tangram shapes, and then we see some self-correcting things like the counting links or the counting screws, pom-pom counting, that sort of material there. It's very clear to students that they have counted out the bolts on the counting screws correctly because the bolts are only long enough to allow for that number of screws to be put on, or the screws, sorry, I said that backward. The screws are only long enough to allow for the certain number of bolts that are necessary there. So thinking about those kind of self-correcting materials, highly engaging, highly impactful things, and also hitting multiple skills at once. So you'll notice that a lot of these are really encouraging of fine motor skills and using the pincher grasp that kids need for writing later on. So we're really hitting a lot of skills in one there. All right, so the Science Center is a super fun one that often is pretty popular. Some ideas for the Science Center are some more kind of open-ended, engaging things like color mixing lenses, gears, animal to object picture match. Those are really popular. So you have little objects and you match them to the picture. Life cycle models are very highly engaging. Things like that. So again, you can see some things that are really highly engaging and practice multiple skills at once there. The Block Center can be very, I feel like I may have skipped one. Let me go back. I did skip one. The Letter Exploration Center. The Letter Exploration Center typically does work best if you are only setting out letters that your students have already learned or that you know are already known by them. But there are lots of fun, engaging materials for exploring letters, like the letter fishing game, Alphabots, where they are moving the little robots to manipulate the letters, can be really engaging. So Play-Doh stamps are a huge popular hit. Using wiki sticks to form the letters, all of those are very engaging and allow students to practice multiple skills at once. Again, they're also self-correcting. Many of those have a self-correcting feature where students can see if they formed the letter correctly or they have matched up letters correctly. Okay, we talked about the Science Center. So the Block Center is often very popular. I'm sure you know that from your own experience in classrooms. So because it is so popular, it often needs a little bit more frequent rotation than the other centers. And there's often, you know, lots of small parts and large pieces in the set. So keep that in mind when you're setting things out. Make sure you're not putting out too many options at once with too many small little pieces. And as we've said before, the deeper play and deeper engagement is often facilitated by fewer choices and more open play space. So making sure you've got enough space available for engaging in a really deep way with each of the materials you've set out in the Block Center. A soft, low pile carpet can be really helpful for keeping the noise down there. As we know, you know, wooden blocks can be really very loud as they kind of crash to a tile floor or a wooden floor. So a low pile carpet can help keep it a little bit more peaceful in that area. But also some smaller block sets and some of the softer ones, if you have like foam blocks, those do really well at like a table. So consider keeping or consider placing a little table in the block area as well, so that kids can really engage in a meaningful way with those smaller, softer sets. So here are some block sets that we see are very popular in preschool classrooms. Magnetic building sets are super popular. I'm sure you've seen that in your classroom. Blockaroos are really fun. So we've got foam building sets, and they make kind of a clicking sound as they come together. They're magnetic, so the pieces can kind of join together and make a clicking sound that preschool students often really like and find highly engaging. And then again, as you see here, many of them are helping to practice those pincher skills that we want our students to develop there. So creativity and developing those fine motor skills that we need are some keys to keep in mind in our block center. So then we often encourage our teachers to have a writing center, and some teachers will set them up in two separate pieces. So a pre-writing center and then an actual letter formation center. So considering your students' needs and their skill levels, think about your students and if they're ready to hold pencils or writing utensils. And if they're not, make sure you're setting up a writing center with some pre-writing activities in there. So we know that many of them just don't quite have that fine motor yet to hold those utensils. Keep in mind that a writing center doesn't necessarily need to have a finished product. Students don't necessarily need to be putting something on paper that they can take home. Anything that's developing that pincher grasp can really be useful here in the pre-writing center. Okay, so some ideas for our pre-writing center are squigs, the smaller ones, where they're squishing the little suction cups together using the pincher grasp. A magnet tab, they're holding the small magnetic wand to bring the magnets up. Dot daubers are very popular for kind of getting that beginning grip of a utensil. Magnetic tracing boards start to encourage that same pincher grasp. And anything with peel and stick, like the little foams where they're foam shapes where they're peeling the paper off and sticking it to paper. Those are all developing those fine motor skills that students need for writing. So if you are putting things in like the peel and stick foam shapes or the dot daubers, make sure you're also providing paper. An easy way to cut down on kind of wasted paper is to cut paper down in size to half or even quarters, because as we know, some of our little ones have the attention span to really kind of fill up a whole sheet of paper, and many of them don't. So providing different sizes of paper can really help cut down on the waste of paper if that's something that you're concerned about in your classroom. Letter stamps, alphabet letter stamps are also really fun. And tracing boards where students are using crayons to kind of etch over kind of gives them the beginning practice that they need for holding a utensil, but they're not necessarily making letter shapes yet. So when your students are ready to hold pencils, crayons, other utensils, introducing a letter formation writing center can be really engaging for them. So providing a variety of materials, again, to encourage your students to write familiar letters or things like names of their classmates. Students love writing their friends' names, so think about stocking that center with things that encourage actual letter formation there. So some ideas that we've seen work really well in classrooms are kind of an easel or a lazy Susan with a variety of art supplies that students can reach and manipulate. Can really make those, you know, a normal pencil much more inviting when you see it set up in that way. Name cards with names of classmates. Craft tape is a huge hit with our students. So using that craft tape to really encourage letter writing or decorating a piece of paper, they're developing those fine motor skills, and it gives them kind of extra incentive to put something down on the paper with their pencil or crayon or whatever they're using. And then of course, we can also get into practicing actual letter formation. Again, keeping in mind that this really is done best when we're providing them with the letters that they've really had clear instruction on in their alphabetics group. So within the alphabetics groups, we really are talking about how to form each letter correctly. So keep that in mind when you're setting things out in the letter formation center, just thinking about what they have had instruction instruction on and what they haven't had instruction on yet. Okay. And then we have two centers that we really encourage putting in your classroom because they help students to really be independent in that center time and help students to take care of situations that can kind of arise during center time on their own. So the first of those two centers is the self-care center. So we know that oftentimes students in preschool will have runny noses or sticky hands or something like that. So we encourage teachers to set up, you know, somewhere in their classroom, a little self-care station where students can on their own take care of their needs like that. So wiping their noses or taking care of sticky hands. So in the self-care center, we encourage things like tissues that are readily available right there where kids can reach them, child safe mirrors so that they can look in the mirror and see, you know, oh, did I get everything or did I not? Hand wipes or hand sanitizer, just kind of depending on what is appropriate and okay in your classroom. I know some classrooms, they don't like to have liquid hand sanitizer down for various reasons. So hand wipes can be really helpful, but something where students can safely take care of sticky hands or cleaning their hands on their own within the classroom can be really helpful. And then, of course, having a trash can with a lid. So everything right together in one little area so that if students have some kind of need with their bodies, they can go to that area and take care of those needs. And then the trash can obviously contains yucky tissues or used hand wipes or that sort of thing neatly. And that independence and taking care of yourself is just huge with preschoolers, and they just feel so empowered and so independent, and it helps the center time to run really smoothly when our students are able to take care of their own needs in that way. And then, of course, we also want to encourage our students to take care of the classroom on their own during this time. So setting up a center where students have the materials they need for taking care of their classroom is something we encourage as well. So thinking about your classroom, anticipating some common interruptions that students might have, you know, oh, something spilled because we have a material with water. How can we, what can we put in our classroom care environment so students can take care of that on their own is just something to be thinking about as you're setting up your classroom care environment. Think about those common things that might happen and provide some materials that your students can help take care of those issues on their own. So thinking through these common interruptions like, you know, I was doing a small group the other day and I had two students come to me and ask me to open the Play-Doh container because they couldn't open the Play-Doh container on their own. Well, if I take some time, you know, right away to take care of that at the end of the day or the next morning, and I put the Play-Doh in a box or some kind of container that students can successfully open, well, then I've taken care of that issue there. So thinking through those kind of common interruptions and making sure your students are independent in each of the materials that you're putting out can really help that center time run smoothly. So some things that work really well in a classroom care center are like a small broom and dustpan for cleaning up dry spills. Sponges that are kept damp can really help with wet spills. Damp sponges actually absorb spills, liquid spills, a lot better than totally dry sponges do. So make sure you're keeping them just a little bit damp and keeping them in like a plastic bucket can be really helpful. A bigger broom and dustpan for cleaning up spills on the floor, towels for larger wet spills, thinking about like a basket for storing your clean towels and maybe a plastic bin for those wet towels before they go in the wash, some microfiber cloths for taking care of dusting around the classroom. All of these things are actually, I know a lot of people have probably seen this in their classroom. Little ones love to help out. They love to be independent in taking care of their space, and they love to be able to solve problems on their own. So think through the things that happen in your classroom and provide the students with what they need to start taking care of those things on their own. Their independence will just soar, their self-confidence will soar, and they will be able to be a little bit more independent and successful in that center time when you provide those things. Okay, so now we're going to talk about the Project Ready Dramatic Play Center. So we already said that as you're setting up your classroom, make sure you're keeping a little space available, because within each unit, there is a theme-based dramatic play center that's introduced. Sometimes the dramatic play center is kind of introduced at the beginning of a theme. Sometimes it comes in later in a theme. The idea there is that students have heard books, they have engaged with books, they have engaged in small group oral language activities where they're using the vocabulary around the theme. So they already have a little bit of schema around that theme that they can take and apply to the dramatic play center. So we want to make sure we are giving kids a little bit of an idea of the theme before we set out our dramatic play center for them to engage in. So thinking intentionally about where to include the dramatic play center can be really helpful. Some of these dramatic play centers are just naturally encourage a little bit more activity. Some of them encourage more of kind of sitting down and engaging with materials a little bit more quietly. So think about the needs of each of the theme-based centers and think about where to set them up in your classroom. And I don't think it needs to be the same spot each time. Okay, so Unit 2 is where we first introduce a dramatic play center, and it is Unit 2 is kindness. It's our kindness unit. So we talk about kindness to families, kindness to each other, and we talk about kindness to animals. So when we begin our section on kindness to animals, we encourage you to set up a little vet center in your classroom. So you're going to set up a dramatic play vet's office in that area of your classroom. And you're going to make sure you have materials available so that children can play different roles, like the vet, the vet's assistant, the pet owner, the receptionist, all of those things. This one does get introduced. This dramatic play center gets introduced after the book Biscuit Visits the Doctor. So they've heard that story. They get a little bit of an idea of the concept of a vet's office and what happens there. And of course, you want to make sure as you introduce these new dramatic play centers, just like when you introduce other centers, you want to make sure that a teacher is available to facilitate the play in the center, provide them with the language prompts that they need, help them with the vocabulary, help them to kind of set up some different play activities, help them to think through some ways to engage with that center. Okay, so in the dramatic play center, we encourage you to set out many of these are Melissa and Doug brands. So a little vet tool set, a vet costume, a pet travel kit. So one child can play the role of the owner taking their animal to the vet. Large kind of self-sticking bandages are a huge hit. And again, we're kind of getting the fine motor activity there of pulling it apart and putting it on the animal, a little kitchen scale so they can weigh the animals, a tape measure so they can measure the animal, and then a little clipboard for kind of taking notes. Anytime we can encourage writing or, you know, pretend writing within our dramatic play center, we want to do that as well. So those are some things to kind of purchase for the dramatic play center. And then within each of our units, we have some materials that we've created and put together for you to use in your classroom. So there are some animal x-rays that are available for you to put in your vet center. There are life cycle cards for dogs and cats. And over here, you see a little paper that you can put on that clipboard so students can circle the pet that's been brought in, how the pet feels, and circle, you know, how they took care of that pet that day. So, and then there's also a space at the bottom for writing the vet's name. So encouraging that writing or the pretend writing, or even just kind of holding the pencil and making marks on the paper within our dramatic play center is something that we're doing there. So Unit 3 is North America. And in Unit 3, we have two different kind of dramatic play centers. One of them is the MAP Center that we're going to really grow as we hit new continents. And if you haven't picked up on it yet, our themes basically do rotate between a continent and like a science or social studies theme. So roughly every other unit, we're studying a continent. And the first one is North America in Unit 3. So you will start kind of a map center in your classroom, and then you will build that map center as you hit each new continent there. So some things to add in there. That we encourage are in interactive globe, small maps that students can explore, especially places that they know, a map of the school or a map of a park, a map of a recent field trip that you've taken together. The puzzle of the world can be really engaging. Any kind of coloring work in crayons so they can color their own map, and paper and pencil to encourage them to map a familiar place there. So this is a map center that we had in one of our classrooms here a few years ago. So you see lots of open-ended kind of engaging things here, and you can see the beginnings of a map there that a student has created with a glue stick and a pencil there. And you can see the map of the United States of America and the world map there. And also the interactive globe is there on the table. So this piece can kind of grow as you hit new continents. Also in North America, we encourage you to set up a nature center. So this one is introduced in the classroom after you read a book called What is Science? So the nature center, students are really going to engage with different nature tools, and they're going to explore natural pieces that they found, and really practice using scientific tools in this center. So we do encourage teachers and to take their classrooms out to do like a nature hike to collect things that they can put in their nature center. I think when it's something that a student has found or their classmate has found, it really just brings engagement up to a new level when they're using these tools to explore the items. So some things that we encourage you to set out in your nature center are the book, What is Science? And we have little cards that show different scientific tools. So you can discuss those different tools and what they're called and how they're used. We have a North America Habitats book that's available in the material section for North America. So students can match different animals to their habitat home. So I think in North America, the habitats we feature are desert, farm, and I think forest. I could be wrong though, but that material is available to you on our website in the North America unit. Magnifying glass, little telescopes are really interesting. Tongs for moving nature items that students have found can be really engaging and again help with the fine motor development there. There's a safari vest that we encourage you to get so students can dress like a naturalist and they can pretend to be a naturalist and explore those little things that they found. And then there are also some activities that we encourage, like color mixing. So this picture down here is a color mixing activity with a little bit of food coloring and droppers. So students are combining in that little paint palette tiny drops of water, and they're seeing what happens when the colors are mixed there. Okay. In Unit 4, the astronomy unit, we have an observatory for our dramatic play center. So you're going to set up an observatory in your science center. So you're going to explain to your students an observatory is where you look at the stars and planets through telescopes. And astronomers are scientists who work at observatories and they study and teach about the stars. If you have an observatory in your city, you can always talk about your observatory and show pictures of it. And here you're going to place kind of pictures of planets and stars. And if you have a solar system model, this is a great place to put it in. Okay, so here are some things we encourage you to put in your observatory center for the astronomy unit. This little astronaut costume is a huge hit with our students. They love to dress like an astronaut and pretend to go on a space mission. This felt solar system is highly engaging and gets a lot of activity in our classroom. So students can move those different planets and space things, astronauts, rockets around on the felt board and kind of create their own little solar system there. This is a telescope that can actually be used. It does work, not super well, but it does work to magnify things. So we encourage you to set up this little telescope near your pictures of planets, and those planet pictures are all available in the astronomy materials section. So set up that telescope where you can take a look, take a peek at each of those planets. These blocks here are phases of the moon blocks. So we do read a lot of books about the moon and the phases of the moon. So students can explore the phases of the moon with those little wooden blocks. Our students really like the rover and the rocket and the astronauts. There's a lot of great pretend play that happens with those toys. And then I think this is the first time I've showed you this idea, but in the dramatic play center, anywhere where you can add books that deal with that theme or that relate to your theme, do so. Add those extra books so students can engage with that theme within the dramatic play center. I think it can really help with engagement and growing their ideas behind the schema that they're studying there. So unit 5A. So 5A means unit 5 in year 1 of implementation. Unit 5A is South America. And in South America, the Dramatic Play Center is an ocean exploration area. So this one doesn't get introduced until part 3 of South America. So that's pretty late in the South America unit. But in part 3, we're talking about ocean animals. So we're going to set up an ocean exploration center. Okay, so here are some materials that we encourage you to set up in your Ocean Exploration Center here for South America. This is a little ocean animals puzzle with little pegs. So it's pretty easy to manipulate. Again, we have a felt board here, but this one is all ocean themes. So all ocean animals, very, very popular and engaging. If you are brave, we suggest you set up a water table to explore with little ocean animals and water. And again, using things like scoopers or tongs can be really beneficial. It makes it even more engaging and helps to engage those muscles that are needed for writing later. Object to picture matches can be really popular with students. This is something that many students find a lot of success in doing independently. So setting out little ocean animals and matching them to picture cards. And then we also have a shell patterning activity. And then we encourage this ocean animals memory game to be set out. Those are all really fun, engaging ways to explore ocean animals. The shell patterning and the object to picture match, those are all available in the materials section for South America. So some of these things are listed for purchase. So you can see, you know, what we have purchased and what we think works really well there. And then anywhere where we need to create a material for you, we have done that. And those are all available in the materials section. Okay. Unit 5B, so that's unit 5 in the second year of implementation, is Asia. And we are just about to start Asia in many of our classrooms right now. So it was just developed and we are super excited to see how it plays out. But the idea behind the Asia Dramatic Play Center is a mountaineering base camp. So this one is going to be introduced in part 2 after students have read about Mount Everest and they've read a little bit about mountaineering and climbing Mount Everest. And the Dramatic Play Center teachers will set out a little base camp. So you're going to explain to your students, you remind them of kind of the concepts behind it, that Mount Everest, the tallest mountain in the world, is in Asia. And people from all over the world travel to Asia to Mount Everest to try climbing. And then again, just like with everything in the classroom, you want to make sure a teacher is available to model how to engage with the materials. And because this one really is a dramatic play center, you want to model some different play schema that could happen there. So modeling how to pack your bag for the journey, how to cook food over a campfire, how to chart your course up the mountain, dress for the journey, and how to climb safely over the terrain using a compass. So all of those concepts are hit in the books about Mount Everest and mountaineering. So they're just going to take those concepts that they've heard in their stories and engage in those in their play. So some things that we are encouraging our teachers to set up for the Asia Dramatic Play Center are this little camping set. It's a Fun Little Toys is the brand name, play tent and an inflatable campfire, prayer flags. We do read about how oftentimes people will bring prayer flags to Mount Everest to hang, a hard hat for that, you know, safely climbing, a compass for navigating the terrain, and a little backpack for storing everything that you need for the journey. And then, of course, because this is a continent unit, we're going to be adding to our map center as well. So adding some maps of Asia to that center to develop those concepts and themes. Okay, so we're really excited. We have not seen this one in action yet, but I think it will be a hit, and I can't wait to see how students do with it. So unit 6 is My Amazing Body, and the Dramatic Play Center there is a healthy restaurant. So it's introduced in part 2 when we are talking about taking care of our bodies. So some things we encourage you to include would be like menus that children make about with different healthy options, making a sign to name your restaurant, and then including like writing tablets for taking orders or for writing down the food, that sort of thing. So again, really encouraging the writing, whether it's real writing, making actual letters, or just kind of pretend writing, taking a writing utensil to paper in your play is something that we encourage students to do there. Again, you want a teacher, when you introduce this, a teacher to be really available to help model playing in those different roles as a waiter or a customer or a chef in the kitchen, and helping students to really use their new vocabulary and language skills there. So here are some things that we set out often in our healthy restaurant. This over here is a felt board. Our students really like felt boards. It is something that just really is a hit with a lot of our preschoolers. So a felt board where students are looking at different food options and kind of sorting them based on the different food groups or that concept of food groups. A chef costume with some tools for cooking, some pretend food. And this is a set with the Velcro pieces so students can practice cutting with the little knife. They can practice cutting those pieces apart, and then a little cooking set with different utensils and pots and pans. So things that you need for setting up a healthy restaurant are what we encourage you to set out for that. And this one is, I'm sure, as you would guess, it is a huge hit with our students. Unit 7A, so unit 7 in the first year of implementation, is Africa. And in Africa, we set out a wild animal vet. That's what the Dramatic Play Center becomes. And in this unit, you're taking some pieces that you've already purchased for previous units. So you're going to take some things from your vet clinic that you used in Unit 2 and the naturalist costume from Unit 3, North America. And then you're going to combine those with some new things to create your wild animal vet. Okay, so the new pieces are animal family figurines and African animals stuffed animal set, and then some African baby figurines with cards to match. So I'll show that here. So from Unit 2, you're going to pull out your vet costume again and maybe some of the vet tools that you used. From Unit 3, you're going to pull out that naturalist costume. And then add these new pieces. So the animal family figurines, the stuffed animals, and we encourage you to get nonfiction books that relate to each of those African animals, stuffed animals in the set. And then also the little baby African animals that match to the pictures there. So lots of different options for dramatic play with those pieces there in the Wildlife Vet Center. Okay. And unit 9 is botany. And in botany, our Dramatic Play Center really centers around butterflies and plants. So it is a little bit of a science center. So we encourage you to do activities like growing plants in a bag, having a butterfly life cycle available, butterfly wings for dress up is such it is just a favorite in our classrooms. They love to dress up like butterflies in the Dramatic Play Center and kind of act out the life cycle of butterflies. We have a lot of cards that are available in the materials section for life cycles. So life cycle of a flower, life cycle of trees, life cycle of butterflies, and then some tools for measuring. And then we have some activities that relate to a book called Happy Bird Day that hits a lot of the themes that we've covered in our botany unit. So the butterfly life cycle model, and then the butterfly habitat where you send away for little caterpillars to be sent to your classroom. These are really, really popular in our classrooms. And it's something that teachers do year after year. Once you have the habitat, you can just send away for new caterpillars to be sent to you. You don't have to buy the whole set again. And students really love watching their caterpillars go through the whole life cycle. Here's an example of the butterfly costumes that you might set out. So big flowy wings and antenna for students to dress in and act out the life cycle. And then some tools for measuring, because we do hit measuring a few times within the botany unit, and some life cycle cards. Those are all available in our materials section for botany. And then we have some activities that relate to this book, Happy Bird Day. One is just nomenclature cards. So some common birds that are found in our area of North America. So in the temperate forest of North America, and then an animal memory picture match here for Happy Bird Day with, again, pictures of those birds that are found in the temperate forests of North America here. The units that are still in development right now are Unit 7B, which is Australia, Unit 8, which is Seasons and Weather, and Unit 10, which is the Arts. Those are all still in development, so we welcome your ideas. If you have brilliant ideas for Dramatic Play Centers for those concepts, we would love to hear them. We know that the teachers we work with are really creative and have great ideas for us, so please send those our way or share them now if you have those great ideas for those units that we're still developing. Okay, so I think we ended. Just a few minutes short of 10 o'clock. So we ended a little bit early. So if you have any questions, we would love for you to share them with us now. If you come across anything or you think of anything as you're kind of thinking through setting up your classroom, please feel free to email me. My name's Rosie Warburg. This is my email address, and you will find my email address right on our readingscience.org website. If you click on the preschool tab, it is listed right there on the website. So if you lose it, feel free to find it and reach out to me with any questions or any suggestions as well. We welcome. Okay. Ladies, do you have anything else, anything that you thought of as we were kind of going through?
No, I think that was great, Rosie. Thank you.
Okay. All right. So if you're not seeing anything new in the chat, are you?
I'm not. All right.
So, you know, if you don't have anything you would like to share, then we will say goodbye. Thank you again for joining us on this cold Saturday morning. It's maybe not as cold where you are, but it is freezing here. So thank you for joining us. Thank you for your interest. And please reach out if you have any questions or suggestions. Okay. I'm going to go ahead. Oh, did you stop recording already?